Cool. All right. So hi, everyone. My name is Thomas de Bel, and I will indeed be talking about stain-transforming cycle-consistent generative adversarial networks for improved segmentation of renal histopathology. So to set a bit of the context, often in medical image analysis, we deal with a single data set. And if we are lucky, we have very nice annotations, a nice training cycle, and great performance on a test set, so life's great. Then enter the reviewer, who says something like, I'm missing performance on external data sets. And that's when you start to sweat. I mean, external data is quite scary, because there is no guarantee on a lower bound performance of these other data sets. They can often have other distributions that your training data didn't account for. Of course, there are options, so often we use data augmentation to train a model, but once the model is trained, we're stuck with it, and if we have a low performance, we can't do anything anymore. We could, of course, train the network with the new data, but that is very cumbersome in the sense that you need new annotations, you need to retrain, you need to split your data and train tests and validation. So there's another option, which is data normalization or transformation. And that's what we're going to focus on, specifically using CycleGANs for that. So yeah, we saw it in the last talk as well, but CycleGAN has had a few successes. So in the original paper, they show a lot of conversions, which are quite lovely, of course, from zebras to horses, summer to winter. And I guess you could get rich from forging Monet paintings, but we're going to focus on stain transformation. So moving from one coloring of the stain to another. So the advantages of a CycleGAN are in our case that it's unsupervised. It can be trained in an unsupervised manner. We don't need any annotations. Furthermore, it's unpaired. We have two different data sets, so we cannot train in a paired way. So the CycleGAN method accounts for that. And furthermore, property which I like to call stain agnostic. So you can train a CycleGAN with any kind of stain. It doesn't really matter, and that's a big advantage when compared to more traditional methods, where these traditional methods are often specifically tailored for a single stain. So how does a CycleGAN work? Let's start with a GAN setup. So we have a generator that needs to learn some target distribution. Often this is either from a noise sampling to, for instance, a face, or from or paired data where we have one image domain and we need to move to another image domain. However, in our case, we don't have the paired data, so we need these somehow to retain the structural integrity of our stained images. And for that, we have the cycle consistency in CycleGANs. So we can move from an input, transform it with one generator, and then the other generator performs a sort of an inverse operation and goes back to the original data. And we can compare the start and the end here and give the network feedback based on how much the original image looks like the double converted image. So that's where the cycle consistency loss is very important. However, the cycle consistency loss on its own doesn't guarantee a stable conversion yet. A nice example here is on the left you see an input image. And if you look closely, the generator learns to basically invert the data, where there is background in the original image, there is now tissue in the converted image, and vice versa. So to deal with that, we added another loss term, which is the identity loss, where we force our generators to basically perform the identity function. And this leads to stable conversion because we are looking at simple solutions first. This is almost already what we would want. We want the structural information there with another coloring. So this is, of course, works against the domain transformation. So after a few epochs, this identity loss is removed. So we also made some changes to the generator architecture. So instead of on the left, we see the original generator architecture, and on the right, we have a simplified architecture, which is way smaller and therefore also faster in terms of computation time and complexity. We do this because we want a simple color transformation, which probably doesn't need a lot of field of view. So that's our stain transformation method. And now we want to compare which is better. Is it enough to use augmentation or is stain transformation better? Do they somehow complement each other? So for that, we made a segmentation task where we have two different data sets. We have data from our own lab, the Radboud University Center, where we have 25 annotated slides, and another data set from the Amsterdam Medical Center, where we have 10 annotated slides. And the task that we are doing is used for the prediction of chronic rejection in renal biopsies, which is also another project in our group. So for the segmentation task, we have identified a set of classes. So you can see here an example in each slide that we have. We have a few regions that are fully annotated. We have a couple of glomerulus classes, which is the big structure you can see here. We have a couple of tubulus classes, arteries, and all the other structures that are found in renal tissue are put in a background class. So this is a really nice segmentation task that we can use to see and compare the performance of learning a segmentation task on one data set, for instance on the Radboud UMC data set, and applying it on the AMC data set, and see what the performance is with and without conversion, and without augmentation. So we have four different setups, basically, four different experiments. One where we train the segmentation network twice, once without augmentations and once with augmentations. And furthermore, after we train these segmentation networks, we apply it on the other data center with or without transforming the stain using the CycleGAN. So we get a sort of a baseline approach where we use neither transformation nor segmentation. And then we use either transformation or augmentation. And we also have a setup where we use both. So we train the segmentation network with augmentations and also apply transformation to see whether they can help each other, basically. So for the segmentation network, we use a standard UNet, no differences between the original approach. And we mainly focus on extensively augmenting in the color space because we want to try to make the segmentation network robust to unseen stains in our case. So for that, we have contrast, noise, brightness, blur, and hue shift augmentations. And these can also be applied in conjunction, so they can be combined. So before we can actually apply the segmentation network, we need to perform our transformation by the CycleGAN. And here we run into a problem. When we train the CycleGAN network, we basically sample tiles. And since we are training with instance normalization in our CycleGAN network, the input distribution of the tiles can influence the output. So you can see here that if we have two tiles on top of each other here, and we naively slide through the patch, we can see in this case that probably due to this smudge in the patch, that there is quite a clear border artifact. And this could, of course, be very detrimental to our segmentation performance. So we deal with that in the following way. So we start with performing inference on very large tiles, so that so if there's a weird patch in there, it doesn't have too much of an effect on the color distribution. Then we crop out the part that is influenced by the padding in the CycleGAN network generator. And finally, we also slide and blur our patches. So that means that we, instead of moving from one patch to the next, we move by half of the patch size. So we get an overlap between subsequent patches. And we blur them by gradually moving, moving from the center to the outermost parts of the patch, we reduce the weight of that patch. So we get a gradual transition between subsequent patches. So visually, this looks something like this. So we have an input patch, Then we have the output patch where we apply the blending. And then if we move through the slide in 2D, of course, each part of the output is seen 4 times in a different patch. And so after a 2D pass, this would be a final output. So this results in the following result. So here you can see that it's basically the border artifact is gone, and we get a very smooth result between tiles. So let's move to some results of the transformation. So here we have an original AMC slide, and when we apply a stain transformation on it, it looks something like this, which looks it looks like it went very successful. Some more zoomed in results. So here we have the original, and here we have the transformed slide or patch, and here we have some reference structures that are the same. And as you can see, they look like they could be from the target data set in this, or from the original target data set. So this is, of course, all very nice, but we want to see whether our transformation actually has some effect on the segmentation performance. So that, for that, I go back to the 4 experiments that we devised. So here are some segmentation results. This is the input, and here we have the ground truth. So to start with the baseline, we can see that, it's basically all over the place. The segmentation results looks quite bad. But this is, of course, to be expected because it has never seen this stain before. Secondly and thirdly, we have the augmentation and transformation. So with the augmentation, we can see that it performs already way better. The difference being that it looks like the application on only the transform data is a lot cleaner. So we see that there is less rubbish in there, less noise. And then finally, we also have the combination where there's hardly any difference actually between the transformation and using both augmentation and transformation. So some results in numbers. So if we look at, so we have two sets of scores, one for the AMC data set, so that's the segmentation network trained on the Radboud data set and then applied on the AMC data set, and vice versa. And we see in general that between the two data sets, the Radboud UMC data set performs overall less, and this is most likely to do with the fact that we had less annotations for the original segmentation training in that set. So most striking here is actually the fact that we, when we perform transformation only, it performs just as well as using both the transformation and augmentation. So in this case, there was actually no merit to using any augmentation at all, and the transformation seemed to have been able to very precisely model the original data distribution. In the other data set, we see a bit of a different result. So here, both augmentation and transformation perform quite equally. And this is also a nice result where the applying both actually results in a higher score. So probably they also can complement each other, transformation and augmentation. So in conclusion, I think we were successful in creating a stain transforming cycle GAN. The results look quite appealing. And our tiling strategy is also able to reduce the border artifacts. And finally, to reiterate, in one of the data sets, our transformation network performed, or transforming the data worked better than augmentation. And in the other data set, we saw that both techniques basically complement each other, which is also a very nice result. So in future research, we will be looking at other data sets as well to see if we can hold the same results for those data sets. And we are also going to compare the CycleGAN method with other more classical approaches, of course. And then finally, we're also going to see if we can somehow also, and it's a bit more risky, move from one type of stain to another type of stain. In our case, we only saw interstain, so we went from one pus stain to another pus stain. And So between different stains, there's a lot of morphological information that can be quite different. So that will be also a nice challenge. So yeah, if I intrigued you or inspired you, I would love you to come to my poster and we can discuss a bit more or ask a question now. And thank you for listening.
Thanks very much, Thomas. I'm sure we're intrigued and inspired, and that we've got some time for some questions.
Hello. Yes, thank you. So you said that you sort of try to prevent the network from indeed doing weird stuff and sort of force it to only do intensity transformations learning. Could you comment a bit more? Did you measure something, how much it really changed the original image if it went through it?
So you mean to this is about the identity loss to yes. For good conversion. So yeah, what we saw is that basically the cycle consistency was retained in those weird images where it was able to invert the tissue. Then the other generator was able to invert the tissue back, where it still looked quite a lot like the original data. Of course, the losses were quite high, but I think it got stuck in those cases in some sort of a local minimum from which it couldn't recover anymore. But the identity loss gives it a push in the right direction in the first few epochs, and then after that it's able to basically move forward on its own.
Okay, but you didn't want to construct something that really only could do intensity transformations sort of in this case? If that's possible. But...
You mean another application in CycleGANs, or?
Yeah, maybe, just something that actually only can do smart intensity transformations and not really build up new structures by itself.
Right. Yeah. So I guess a lot of the data normalization techniques all try to do some smart tricks, and this is a bit more elaborate in the sense that you actually are training a neural network, but. This is a thing that we are going to compare. Are there simpler approaches that basically perform just as well? Of course, we saw with the augmentations, there we already induced quite some variance during the training of the segmentation network. And we also saw that the difference between segmentation and augmentation, between augmentations and transformations differed depending on the data set, and using only augmentations and we saw that using transformation performed a bit better, so.
So first of all, very nice piece of work and great presentation, so many congratulations on that. You set out to achieve what you called stain agnostic performance, so you could get more or less similar kind of performance on external data sets. My question is, you tried this unit-based segmentation algorithm on two data sets. One of them, which the original algorithm was performing relatively poor on, you went from 0.36 to 0.85. The other one, which the algorithm was performing relatively better on, you went from 0.46 to 0.73. Do you have any insight into why you couldn't do better on the data set where the original performance was a little bit better?
It's a good question. So I think you started with the stain agnostic part. So the stain agnostic part is just about the fact that we can train any kind of stain conversion. And furthermore, for the results, I have no... I don't really know why the performance was so low in one of the data sets and then went up way more when you apply one of the techniques, and in the other data set it was a bit higher in the baseline and the performance didn't grow that much. This probably has to do with the fact that one data set had a lot of annotations, so more variance during training, and the other data set had very few annotations, and this maybe the other data set should have had a few more annotations, and then we could have gotten comparable results. But this is also actually quite interesting, I would say.
Other questions?
Question up the back there.
Hi there. Nice work. Can you make any comments on the training stability of the CycleGAN, and did you find it fairly robust and easy to train, or difficult?
So in the beginning, we had quite a few failed attempts. So it is indeed hard to get to a good conversion. And what we mainly saw is that when adding this identity loss, and that's what we tried after a few failed attempts, we saw that basically that was enough to converge, stably converge to a good point in every training setup. So that really helped.
Thank you. Very nice work. So could you go to the images of the experimental results, that page
for
the results? So the final result.
This one?
So, the one you just passed. So for the both, the images, the pictures.
Oh, sorry, this one? Yeah. Okay, yeah, they're all pictures, right?
Okay. Yeah, yeah. So,
continue, sorry.
Yeah, so it looks like the both column actually performs worse the transform in this case, because comparing to ground truth, there shouldn't be a green area at the left corner, right?
So, yeah.
So do you have any insight of this? Is this just a special case? Or?
So these are, of course, these are examples. So. Okay. I think in this case, actually, the ground truth might actually be wrong here.
I see.
That could be the case, yes.
I have another question. If I remember correctly, in the original CycleGAN paper, the identity mapping was already introduced in the CycleGAN paper, in that original paper. So do you think so? So I think you talk about the one-to-one mapping. It looks like you guys tried out, I remember it's already in the original paper, the one-to-one mapping in the CycleGAN.
Are you talking? So I'm sorry. I think you were talking about the identity loss. Like
yes.
So there's a very subtle difference. I think so what I did, it's quite similar. But what the CycleGAN approach uses is they you have a source data set that you put into the generator, and you would want to move to some target.
Yes.
And I put in the source and want to go to source.
Okay.
And they add in a term where they force to as an input they give the target data set and force it to move to the target data set.
Okay.
So it's all in another kind of identity loss, but it's very similar.
All right, thank you.
So we have a question up the top of the stairs that's been waiting up the back.
Yes, thanks for the great talk. I have a question to the normalization. Why is it actually not possible to do that deterministically with traditional tools?
Yeah, that's of course a good question, and we tried a few very basic approaches, but this was one of the things that to us, so what I think is that these deep learning neural networks are able to model the basically the nonlinear color transformations. So I think if you use very simple approaches, which is linearly maybe shift the color distribution a bit, you won't get as good results. But this is, of course, something we want to still compare in a follow-up. Yes.
Thank you.
OK, let's thank the speaker.